Sometimes it's the demons that are already inside of you which do the most plotting and scheming just so that they can exercise the authority over your system. Get deliverance. The kingdom of hell is very intelligent. They are systematic. They strategize. They meet. They have councils. They have a hierarchy. And so you can have demons inside of you. They're communicating with each other. They are talking. They are planning things. And they are planning these things in conjunction with other spirits that may be in the air, other spirits that may be in other people, other spirits that may be in the community, other spirits that may be around you. So they'll plan things with, also those demons will also plan things with witches, warlocks, and sorcerers. So a witch, a warlock, and a sorcerer, they can be in communication with a demon that dwells inside of you and you wouldn't even know it. Sometimes spirits are actually sent and projected on an assignment by a sorcerer, by a witch, by a wizard. They'll be projected into someone's life. And that spirit now has a line of communication with the person, the personality, the principality, the power that sent it. So the most scheming is done a majority of the time internally. That's why you have to submit yourself to the process of deliverance, no matter how anointed you are. The devil is not, he's not intimidated by your anointing. I need you to understand this. Because he's killed people more anointed than you. He's not intimidated by how old you are or how young you are, because he's killed younger and he's killed older. And I mean believers. He's not intimidated by how gifted or skilled you are, because he's corrupted people who are more gifted, who are more skilled than you. So it doesn't matter how rich you are. It doesn't matter how many degrees you have. None of that is important, because it doesn't intimidate the enemy. And that is not the mark of authority. Understand this. Because a lot of times we, in our mind, because maybe you've seen a demon leave someone and they growl and stuff like that, so it'll give you the impression that these beings are not intelligible beings, but they are. A lot of times that growling and stuff like that is just so that they can throw you off. But internally they communicate with each other. Internally they talk. And so a lot of times what happens is that through salvation, the power and the influence of the enemy can be suppressed. Some believers suppress it by discipline. They suppress it by word of faith and all that stuff. But just because you have suppressed the demon and you've suppressed the urges doesn't mean that the demon has left. You have to cast the spirit out. And some spirits that you have to cast out are familiar spirits. Familiar spirits oftentimes are spirits that know the household. You have to cast out monitoring spirits. Monitoring spirits are spirits that watch and wait. Let's go back to familiar spirits. Familiar spirits oftentimes, they are familiar with every person in the family, with the generations of the household. A familiar spirit can come in the form of someone who was in your bloodline. And so it's not them. The familiar spirit is wearing their image. You have to cast these spirits out. Number two, monitoring spirits. Spirits that are sent to wait and watch. These are spirits that they'll be around you. They can be sent in the form of animals. They can dwell inside of someone. They can dwell in objects. You want to make sure you saturate your environment with the presence, the power, and the fire of the Holy Spirit. That's why it's necessary to have an intense prayer life. Number three, ancestral spirits. These are spirits that are attached to an individual as a result of transgressions. The purpose of these three spirits, the familiar, the monitoring, and the ancestral spirit, when they connect with someone in the next generation, the purpose is to get that person, is to get you to do something which will now activate it. So a lot of times those spirits are laying dormant in people's lives. They are dormant, but they're still there. They're just waiting for the right moment. They're just waiting for you to do something that will activate it and give it a right to be operational in your life. Good example, I prayed for a young lady with a tattoo before, and she had a tattoo of a lady that was dancing on the water. she said that she was just drawn to get this tattoo. But now every time she would go through deliverance, she herself would begin to dance like the lady in the tattoo that she had. And when I was casting the spirits out, it was revealed that the spirit that was laying dormant in her, that now influenced her, it was speaking to her, go get this tattoo, go get this tattoo. Because it knew that if she went and got it, it would now strengthen its hold over her life, and it would now give it the right to be more expressive in and through her life. It's the same principle of God. The more you sacrifice in spirituality, the more you sow into life, the more God finds expression through you. The level of power you operate in when you pray for 3 hours every day for 6 months is not the same level that you operate in when you pray for 15 minutes every day. The more you sacrifice, the more you get. That's the same thing with spiritual things. So the same way God is waiting for you to make certain decisions so that he can operate and function freely through you is the same way the enemy who may be hiding in your body is orchestrating things and whispering things to you and trying to get you to do certain things so that it can strengthen its hold to you. Is this making sense to you? And so for those of you, you wake up, oh, I just feel like getting a tattoo. There's a reason why you feel like getting a tattoo. You didn't just wake up thinking about it randomly. There's a reason why you want to get that extra piercing. There's a reason why you feel drawn to this person and you know that you and them are going to fornicate. There's a reason why you find yourself being drawn to certain things. There's a reason why you're drawn to the club. There's a reason why you're drawn to alcohol and to drinking. There's a reason why, because you have spirits inside of you and they want to put you in a position that will give them a legal right to function even more freely because they're not comfortable at the level that they're functioning through you. Truly, the truth is that they want complete control of your body. They want complete control of your system. They want complete control of you. And they will continue to cause you to do things or engage in things to weaken and break down your mind, your willpower, your ability to say no, so that its influence can be strengthened and magnified in your life. So they will usually wait until a certain time to manifest. They're waiting for you to slip up. I was reading a book before, and this man, he was a sorcerer, a young man who was a sorcerer, and he was trained by the devil himself, but he was trained in sorcery. And so he said what he would do was that there were certain Christians that he could not interact with or he could not affect their life. He couldn't affect their life because they were living godly lives. And so he said spiritually that when someone was either unsaved or when someone was a Christian living an ungodly life, before him, they would appear completely naked. Because of that, they were unclothed and he had a right to do things to their life. But when a Christian lived a life of godliness, lived according to the precepts of the word of God and loved God, then they would appear fully clothed before him when he looked at them. And because of that now, he had no room to affect them. So what he would do, he said one time, there was a young lady who was leaving a church and he appeared in that place and then he was trying to talk to her. The purpose of talking to her was so that he can get her to say something or say something to her that'll cause her to act in a certain way that'll now make her vulnerable. And so what he did, he saw that she was clothed. So he couldn't just throw demons at her. He couldn't throw attacks at her, and et cetera. So what he did was that when he tried to talk to her and she wouldn't talk to him, he began to call her all types of names. He began to call her a prostitute. He began to call her all these things. He was calling her all these things, and she turned around, and she got very angry, and she began to argue with him, and she acted out and responded in rage. And he said that when she did that, it was almost as if there was an opening. And when she did that, he said he threw spirits of prostitution and harlotry at her. And he said a few months later, she backslid from the faith and she became a prostitute simply because she opened that door as a result of her reaction. The fruit of the spirit is not just something that you do to be good and kind and nice so that people can like you. No, it's a guard and a defense.